Good morning. In the beautiful rolling hills of Western Maryland lies the historic battlefield of Antietam. There on September 17th, 1862, was fought the bloodiest battle in ending any single day of an American war. More than 30,000 soldiers from both sides of the Civil War lay dead or wounded on that day. The battle was finally won, and largely by the heroic exploits of the Irish Brigade, known as your Fighting 69th. Several years ago, I was invited to celebrate a mass on that sacred field, sacred because so many thousands of young men from the North and South are buried there, right where they died. The occasion was the dedication of a Celtic cross to honor the gallantry of that Irish brigade. The day before that dedication, thanks to a graduate student at the Catholic University of America, I happened upon a letter buried in the National Archives 135 years. It was written from the headquarters of the Irish Brigade in Harper's Ferry on October 9, 1862, by Lieutenant Bernard O'Neill, commanding officer of Private Thomas Connors. It is addressed to the private's father here on Mulberry Street in what is now Lower Manhattan. Dear sir, I have just received your letter of the 6th instant. Your brave and gallant son, Thomas, was buried among the other brave men of the 69th who fell in battle. All last winter, his comrades in Company C were edified by his regular attendance at Mass every morning, and also by his so often approaching Most Holy Sacrament of the Eucharist. He was also at confession on the morning of battle. So you must not mourn his fate, as I trust he now stands in the presence of God, interceding for his old comrades of the Irish Brigade, who were not so fortunate as he was to be called by the Almighty when he had everything prepared for the great and inevitable journey to heaven. I believe that Captain Whitty saw him fall. And as the captain is now in New York, he will be able to let you know all about Thomas, and I'm sure he will assist you. I myself assisted in carrying him from the place where he fell to his grave. I assisted in burying him. The scapulars and the beads, the angustae which were around his neck, were buried with him. And 3 letters, which I enclose herewith, were given to me by one of his comrades named George Decker, who found them on his person. If there is anything more you wish to know about him, I will give you the information with pleasure. And if you intend exhuming the body, I will describe to you minutely the place where he is buried. But it would be difficult to find him after the lapse of so long a time, to identify him from his comrades. And besides, what better grave could a brave soldier have than on the field where he fell and where he contributed to gain the victory? It touched me deeply that that mass I celebrated on that Antietam battlefield was the first time that letter was publicly read since Mr. Connors had read it to the proud but grieving family and friends of young Thomas. Indeed, as I read it, I was deeply moved, as were the several hundred listeners on that cold and windswept battlefield of Antietam. And so today, I would address you modern-day members of the Irish Brigade, the historic Fighting 69th. Does your service in uniform in any way conflict with your faith in God, whatever that faith may be? May I remind you of the words of our Second Vatican Council, stating the official teaching of our Catholic Church: all those who enter the military service in loyalty for that country should look upon themselves as the custodians of the security and freedom of their fellow countrymen. And when they carry out their duty properly, they are contributing to the maintenance of peace. Yours is indeed a vocation, and for most of you, a noble Christian vocation, responding to the very words of Jesus, "Greater love than this no one has, than to lay down one's life for one's friends." And you are willing to lay down your lives not only on behalf of friends, but for unknown but helpless faces halfway around the world. As he entered the war against slavery, perhaps young Thomas Connors had in mind St. Patrick himself, who had been a captured slave for 6 years, far from home in his early life. It was during those days of lonely wilderness and solitude and exile that young Patrick learned to pray and then to offer his life to Christ for the people of Ireland. Later it was that he heard in a dream, "I saw, as it were, a man coming from Ireland with letters, and he gave one of them to me. And as I read the beginning of the letter concerning the voice of the Irish, they cried out to me, 'We entrust thee, holy youth, that you come and hereafter walk with us.' And so he returned to Ireland. In those perhaps 40 years of what he saw himself as Christ's slave, he faced daily threats and even death at the hands of primitive pagan chieftains and supreme overlords. In the end, Irish legend tells us, he is said to have baptized tens of thousands, built hundreds of churches, ordained 3,000 priests, and 370 bishops. Centuries later, Thomas Connors was one of the 1.5 million who, clinging to that ancient faith, fled Ireland for America during the Great Famine of the 19th century. Most sailed up the Narrows to New York Harbor on hundreds of coffin ships, on which in 1847 alone, almost 2,000 died during their 3,000-mile voyages. Survivors settled in the cities of the Northeast, and it was among these that young Irishmen of New York formed the Fighting 69th Infantry Regiment at the start of the Civil War. Thomas was one of those 3,000 casualties suffered during that bloodiest day of the war. And Cheatham largely accounts for the presence in such great number of you troops who fill these pews of St. Patrick's Cathedral this morning, troops of the Fighting 69th. No longer largely Irish or even Catholic, nevertheless, you carry on the noble, heroic traditions of the Irish Brigade with its roots in the Revolutionary War, and then outstanding service in the Civil War, the First World War and the legendary Father Francis Duffy, the Second World War, Iraq and Afghanistan. The 69th was the first military unit to respond to 9/11's World Trade bombing, losing two of your members on that tragic morning. As we salute you men and women of the Irish Brigade, we hope that you are justifiably proud of the life of generous self-sacrifice which your military service calls you to. And that witness of self-service for others is a message our culture desperately calls for these days. Would it not be appropriate again for us to stand and show our appreciation for today's members of the Fighting 69th and the Irish Brigade? Thank you, thank you, thank you. But what does this have to do with St. Patrick or the day we celebrate? It's about faith. The strong, motivating faith of Gary Owen Thomas Connor, planted by Patrick 1,600 years before, a faith which ever since has propelled Patrick's spiritual sons and daughters. An Irish faith that continues to challenge and change lives in every corner of the world, and lives not necessarily Catholic or even Christian. Try to count the countless missionaries from across the Irish Sea to New York, whose religious families, largely Irish in origins, still impact our lives. Once young, Sisters of Charity, Sisters of Presentation, Dominican and Ursuline sisters, pioneering women who founded the largest private school system the world has ever seen. Their spiritual investment in serving the poorest in large part accounts today, for instance, for this archdiocese's inner city scholarship fund, for decades offering minority students an only hope for the future. That faith in the God-given dignity of every human life explains the vitality of our vast network of Catholic health services, residences for the aging and the poor, the addicted and the abandoned. That faith also inspired John Cardinal O'Connor and Mother Agnes Donovan to found the Sisters of Life in 1991. Now with more than 100 joyful sisters in the US and Canada, and with a fourth special vow to protect and enhance the sacredness of human life, especially unborn life in the womb, and how crucial their cause is now. For today, we are at a local moment when recent legislation permits liquidating the lives of born babies, living babies. We thank the Sisters of Life for their witness to the dignity of such helpless, vulnerable lives. In a special way this morning, we thank our Archbishop, your Archbishop, Timothy Michael Dolan, for challenging a culture which, believe it or not, proudly permits such atrocities upon newborns. And in the name of compassion, thank you, Cardinal Dolan, for your courageous leadership. As faithful New Yorkers, should we not celebrate his 10th anniversary as our Archbishop? Stand and applause your eminence right on. We need your voice. We have your back. Welcome to Timmytown. Spiritual writers remind us that paganism is never conquered. It survives in its basest form in every human heart. But now, as we see today, it is even arising with acclaim in our public squares. Some claim that our modern public square is too toxic to carry on the faith. I think they have a point. A secular and godless culture threatens to poison our faith and put it to death. If we are to survive as persevering and faithful disciples of St. Patrick, we must sink deep roots in Jesus Christ, Eucharistic roots, and so become in a way like trees, which while inevitably absorbing tons of pollutants in urban wastelands, by the grace of God, still are able to pour out clean oxygen of sacrificial love to the world. This has been our heritage, and it is now our heritage on this St. Patrick's Day. This is Lent. It is Lent, as we all know, but on her patron's feast, the Church of New York gratefully gives us time out. So let the parade begin. But ever mindful of this parade's beginnings, of the gift of faith God has given us in the faith of St. Patrick, the gift of faith that pulsated in that young and brave New Yorker, Thomas Connors, the gift of faith that built and still breathes in and through these sacred stones of St. Patrick's Cathedral, and the gift of faith that desperately seeks renewal in the hearts of each of us who celebrates our patron on this day. Indeed, happy St. Patrick's Day.